Lord, have mercy on us. God the Father in heaven, have mercy on us. God the Son, Redeemer of the world, have mercy on us. God the Holy Spirit, have mercy on us. Holy Trinity in one God, have mercy on us. May we understand your holy will. Grant our prayer, O Lord. May we realize our true relationship with you in this life and the life to come. Grant our prayer, O Lord. May we continue to work with you in building your kingdom on earth. Grant our prayer, O Lord. May we unite ourselves with you in the sacred mystery of the altar. Grant our prayer, O Lord. May we recognize the greatness of this most holy sacrifice through which we worship you. Grant our prayer, O Lord. May we feed on the bread of life, no more than hunger. Grant our prayer, O Lord. May we have a share in the offering of Jesus on the cross. Grant our prayer, O Lord. May we who fill our lives with your ideals be joined with you in the supper of the Lord. Grant our prayer, O Lord. May we receive always and everywhere your all-pervading presence. Grant our prayer, O Lord. May we end our days with your holy name in our hearts and on our lips. Grant our prayer, O Lord. Forgive our sins, O God. Grant our prayer, O Lord. Cleanse and renew our hearts. Grant our prayer, O Lord. Lord, bless us with the wisdom to praise you in spirit and in truth, so by following your holy will, we may gain eternal salvation. Amen. Well, I welcome you here this morning for the first Sunday of the Epiphany season. And so if you remember, the Magi were on the windowsill, slowly making their way here. They got a little bit closer last week on Friday Epiphany. They actually made it into the manger. And so now the three wise men have replaced the shepherds. And so we are now in the Epiphany season, and we will be until February 2nd, actually. So this is a little bit of a change, but still in that celebration of Jesus' birth. And so yesterday we had a little bit of snow. YMS of ours still went out and had our annual meeting at Johnny's Tavern, and the place was mobbed. I couldn't believe it. People are able to go out in the middle of a snowstorm, and I guarantee some people are not here today because, oh, we had a terrible storm last night. They dared not go out to church on Sunday morning. So I'm not buying it, though, because that restaurant was mobbed yesterday. And we also have a little trick, I think, that the YMS of ours latched onto to maybe increase attendance. So we go to these meetings, and it was about 2 years ago. I know Mark is here. Where's Mark? Where's Mark Lawrence?
He's not here.
He's not here? Yeah. Oh, you got dropped. Oh, never mind. Mark's late. So Mark Lawrence took off from the table when we had our YMS of our meeting. So since he took off, we elected him as president of the YMS. Yeah, so he's our president because he left. Last year, Carl, right there, talking to his wife, he took off at one point during the meeting, so we elected him as our vice president. And then yesterday, Chris Lynch, who was supposed to be there, he decided that he had a sore throat and couldn't come out with us, so he has now replaced Carl. He is our vice president because he wasn't there. So for all those people that are going to use a little bit of snow as their excuse for not coming to church, we got to start figuring out that same kind of whyness or our logic, that if you don't come, you're going to get even more jobs. So it works for the YMS of our, maybe it'll work for Holy Name too. And also, I just want to mention, we have a guest over here, Maureen, and Maureen is from Frontier Cable Access Television, and she's planning to do a couple of really cool shows for the public access. She wants to do Zumba, put that on television, and she also wants to go to different local restaurants and interview the chefs there about what their signature dishes are and the preparation and etc. And so she's here to learn how to use the camera equipment and all that, and what better guys than our cameraman here to teach her. So Maureen will be here for maybe 2 or 3 weeks to learn how to do that. But as we do gather for this, the first Sunday of first Sunday of Epiphany, please make an examination of your conscience. Now recite the Confiteor together. I confess to Almighty God, one in the Holy Trinity, who knows the innermost secrets of my heart, that I have sinned in thought, word, and deed, by my fault, by my own great fault. In your presence, O God, I publicly express sorrow for the many sins by which I have offended you. I resolve to amend my life, to improve and sanctify it, endeavoring henceforth to serve you faithfully all the days of my life. I ask all those who dwell within the Church of Christ, the Blessed Mother Mary, the Holy Apostles, Martyrs, and Faithful, who have lived, suffered, and died for the gospel of Jesus Christ, as well as you, my brothers and sisters, to witness my confession and pray for me to our Lord God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. May the Almighty and merciful Lord grant us pardon, absolution, and remission of our sins. May our Lord Jesus Christ absolve you, and with his authority vested in me, I absolve you from all your sins, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Show us your mercy, Lord.
And grant us your salvation.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And let our cry come to you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Grant, most gracious Father, that in purity of heart, we may worthy fulfill this holy action, established in remembrance of the Last Supper and the death of Jesus Christ, and for our sanctification and salvation. Be present among us, Jesus, our most perfect Master, because you said there were two or three are gathered together in my name, you are among them. We also ask, Lord, that through this holy liturgy, may experience a spiritual revival and a better understanding of your holy will, bringing us together in one great family, guided by your commandments and by love, truth, and justice. And may we say together, let us praise the Holy Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God, indivisible, revealed in triune power, for all time, now, and forever.
Glory to God in the highest,
and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, Heavenly King, Almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, Holy Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, and the glory of God the Father. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
Let us pray. Almighty Lord and Father, who sent us your only begotten Son to be an example for us of a holy life here on earth, grant we beseech you that we who worthily imitate his example may ever return all of our thoughts and all of our actions to you. We ask this through the same Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
The lesson prescribed by the Church for this morning's Holy Mass is taken from St. Paul's first epistle to the Corinthians. If I speak with human tongues and angelic as well, but do not have love, I am a noisy gong, a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and with full knowledge comprehend all mysteries, if I have faith great enough to move mountains but have not love, I am nothing. If I give everything I have to feed the poor and hand over my body to be burned but have not love, I gain nothing. Love is patient, love is kind. Love is not jealous, it does not put on airs. It is not snobbish. Love is never rude, it is not self-seeking. It is not prone to anger, neither does it brood over injuries. Love does not rejoice in what is wrong, but rejoices with the truth. There is no limit to love's forbearance, to its trust, its hope, its power to endure. Love never fails. Prophecies will cease, tongues will be silent, knowledge will pass away. Our knowledge is imperfect, and our prophesying is imperfect. When the perfect comes, the imperfect will pass away. When I was a child, I used to talk like a child, think like a child, reason like a child. When I became a man, I put childish ways aside. Now we see indistinctly, as in a mirror. Then we shall see face to face. My knowledge is imperfect now, then I shall know even as I am known. There are in the end three things that last: faith, hope, and love. And the greatest of these is love. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. God sent forth his word and healed them and delivered them from destruction.
Amen.
Alleluia, alleluia.
Alleluia, alleluia.
Praise him, all his angels. Praise him, all the heavenly hosts.
Alleluia, alleluia.
Cleanse my heart and my lips, Almighty God, and cleanse the lips of the prophet Isaiah with a burning fire. In your mercy, cleanse me so I may worthy proclaim your holy gospel through Christ our Lord. Amen. May the Lord be in my heart and on my lips, that I may worthy proclaim his holy gospel. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. Luke.
Glory be to you, Lord.
And Jesus' father and mother were amazed at what was said about him. And Simeon blessed him and said to Mary, his mother, "Behold, this child is destined for the fall and the rise of many in Israel, to be a sign that will be contradicted. And you yourself, a sword will pierce, so that the thoughts of many hearts, they may be revealed." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Jesus coming into the world obviously defines Christianity, but the fact that we are a Christian religion, I think that's really kind of set apart from others by that emphasis of love. It defines who we are, and if we don't have it, we are no longer Christian. The writers of the New Testament, they had three separate words at their disposal for love. There was filio, and you know, that's like the town of, or the city of Philadelphia. It's an ordinary, unexceptional kind of love. It's like bumper sticker kind of love. You know, I love my mud, I love New York, that kind of stuff. It's ordinary. There's nothing out of the ordinary from that. And if Jesus even said that, you know, if you love those who love you, well, big deal. He says everybody does that. There's nothing exceptional about that. There's another word for love, and it's eros. And you can kind of hear where that word is going to lead to. And that word never makes it into the New Testament. It's really not a church word. It's, even if you got eros, you take a movie and it becomes PG-13. So eros is not something you're going to talk about in church. But Christian love is a special word. It's agape. And this is an unconditional love. And it's an initiating love. It's not a reciprocal love. And that's something really important. You know, if a parent loves a child and the child loves the parent, or if a husband loves a wife and the wife loves a husband, you know, that's normal love. But agape is different. It reaches out universally, and it doesn't really even care if it's returned. And that's love the hard way. That's love the Christian way. It has to be a way of life. Jesus says if we love those who love us, again, big deal. It's nothing to brag about. So Christian love is like God's love, and that's hard. And Christian love, like God's love, is a constant. And Jesus explains it by a little parable. He says to his first followers, God's love is like the sun. It comes up and it shines on everybody. It
doesn't only shine on the good people and then there's a shadow following the bad people. It shines on everybody. He says it's like the rain. The rain comes and it rains on everybody. It's not like the good farmer gets the rain and the bad farmer's land is parched. God sends his rain, his sun, and his love to everybody. And there's a really important message there. That agape is universal and it's constant. It's offered without concern of whether it will be returned or even if it's deserved. When Jesus is on the cross and he says, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. These are people that are intentionally tortured, making his death as horrible as possible, and yet that love is still there because it doesn't matter if it's deserved, it doesn't matter if it's returned. That's Christian love. That's agape. It is love as initiative, not as response. And this is the love that Paul today says is the greatest of these. Faith, absolutely necessary. Hope, absolutely necessary. But love, agape, that's the bedrock of what Christianity is about. And that message of agape is where we start the new year. That's why we read 1 Corinthians 13 every year on First Epiphany. This is the bedrock in which we build everything that's going to follow throughout the year. Agape is going to set our course. You know, I recently finished a book called Now, the Physics of Time. I got through interlibrary loan right in our little Tilton Library. That little building there can reach out to all of Western Mass and bring almost any book you want right here to our doorsteps. And the author is one of those strange hybrids. He's a world-renowned scientist who actually takes the time to pray. He doesn't just believe in a creator God. He believes in a God that listens to us, that cares about us, and that when you pray to him, you build a relationship with him. And he doesn't believe only what he kept calling the quantifiable, that reality is a lot more than can what only be measured. And in his book, he was trying to define now. And that's a complicated subject for a physicist because for them, time is not constant. And he even spoke about lab experiments that show time actually moving in reverse. They can actually watch this time moving in reverse. And that stuff absolutely amazes me because the ordinary is so extraordinary that it makes belief in God seem not so far-fetched. But the thought that he closes with is based on this idea of the Big Bang, that about 14 billion years ago there was this moment of creation. All the universe came from that moment of creation. And scientists speak about space expanding ever since that Big Bang. And time expands with space. So now is the edge of time. We can anticipate the future, he says, but the future is not yet real. And this religious scientist says that it's true even for God because God has chosen to create a universe in which chance and freedom mean that the future cannot be foretold because the future is being born right in this moment, this now. It's not that God doesn't know the future because he's not smart enough. It's that God doesn't know the future because God wants and allows and intends that we build the future now. What this means is that when we run across a story in the Bible, like today's gospel account of Simeon, who foretells the future of Jesus and what it's going to mean for Mary, a sword will pierce your heart as well, that it's not a real existent future yet, but because he is wise enough, he can play the present future, play the present forward. And Simeon could see what a life dedicated to agape would mean for Jesus. Love is going to tick off an awful lot of people. You go against the stream when you love, when everybody else hates those people. Your job is to love them. You try to do that and you see how hard it is. And Jesus lived that to the extreme. And that playing the present forward is not only for prophets like Simeon. It is for all of us. This past Monday, for example, was National Science Fiction Day. And that date was chosen because of the birthday anniversary of Isaac Asimov, the great science fiction writer, right from down in Boston. And science fiction is not supposed to be only make-believe. That scientist and that author spoke of a science fictional way of thinking. He wrote, "No sensible decision can be made any longer without taking into account not only the world as it is, but the world as it will be. We can't only think of today. We have to think about tomorrow and even the far distant tomorrow. There's no future me somewhere out there that's already been decided, in other words. Each of us is creating who we will be tomorrow, today. So now is as close to the future as we can ever get. And this means that the present, the now, is full of consequence. It was as Isaac Asimov was talking about when he said that we have to think about the world as it is and the world as it will be. What we do today has effects tomorrow, and we have to remember that constantly. You know, when a television station decides that they're going to try a new show, they don't buy 2 years. They buy like a short run. They test. They see how it goes. If people like it, then they buy the program. You know, a few years back, I was running Google Beta something, and that was a test from Google so they could see if people liked what it was. They test, and then if it's successful, then they continue. And there may be some merit in that for us as well. Maybe we need to test how we are going to act as church, how we are going to act as Christians, because there is no definite place where we are expected to be tomorrow. We're building it now. And our job as Christians is to constantly test how best to express our faith, how best to express that idea of agape, so that we can become the best person that is possible for who we are. And as we get closer and closer, I wouldn't be at all surprised after we test and test and test to find out what Christianity means for me so that we build our future. I wouldn't be surprised at all if there's more and more agape. There's something essential in agape. Faith points us in the right direction. Hope gives us the encouragement to keep going in that direction. But agape, that's the destination. That's where we have to get. And that's why we begin with that message almost on the first of the year, every year. Because we have to better understand, we have to better practice what it means to love like Jesus loves. And so that the greatest of these, that Christian love that may be a part of our lives, for that may we pray in his most holy of names. Amen. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Almighty Lord, on this first Sunday of the Epiphany season, as we gather before your altar, we offer our prayers in memory of Bernard Kale and the 19th anniversary of his death, as offered by the Foster and Poe family. We offer our prayers for sister-in-law Sandy, who has MS and is recovering from surgery for a broken leg and hip, as offered by Teresa Belial and the Belial family. And I offer prayers for Reverend John Balcom, who passed away on January 3rd at the age of 98. He was a friend and an Episcopal priest for nearly 75 years. We also offer prayers at this time for Carol Ann Osowski, my cousin Keith Osowski's wife. She passed away on January 2nd at the relatively young age of 56. And we also continue to offer our prayers for those who are battling cancer. Meg Connors by Ellen and Don Sprosky. Randy Clements by her grandmother Dottie Baronis, Fathers Ray Dreda, and Maurice Lizelle is offered by myself. Richard Poe is offered by the Poe and Foster families. 2-year-old Jack Seela is offered by Mariana Foster. Alex, who is 16 years old, battling lymphoma, Hodgkin's disease, and Alicia, a young mother of 3 with stage 4 breast cancer. Liz Richmond, also diagnosed with cancer, raising 3 young girls on her own. And those 3 intentions are being offered by Cindy Benjamin. We also offer our prayers for Frank Sprosky, as offered by his brother John, Sprosky, Gates, and Kirkendall families. Are there any intentions that you would like to offer from the congregation?
Daisy Vieira, she just was diagnosed with breast cancer.
Another cancer. Okay. We'll pray for Stacy. Any other prayers that you would like to offer? For all these prayers, Lord, plus the private ones that we bring before your altar. And we also ask you, Lord, to bless each and every one of us here gathered, to be with those who are parish who are not able to be with us here today, and those who are parish who have chosen not to be with us here today. And for all these things together, Lord, we pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Glory be to the Father, to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
As was the beginning, is now, and ever shall be.
Eternal rest grant unto him, O Lord. May he rest in peace. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
I believe in one God,
the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God to true God, begotten not made, of one being the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he was born of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in fulfillment of the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead. His kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. I, for the abundance of your steadfast love, will enter into your house. I will bow down towards your holy temple in awe of you. I will bless the Lord. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Receive this offering, most holy Trinity, which we make in remembrance of the passion, resurrection, and ascension of our Lord Jesus Christ, in honor of the Blessed Virgin Mary and all the saints, that it may add to their honor and aid our salvation. May they, whose memory we honor on earth, intercede for us in heaven. We ask this through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Pray, my brothers and sisters, that our sacrifice may be accepted to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice of your hands, for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and for the benefit of his holy church.
Amen. Confirm us, O Lord, in your holy love, so that relying on your providence and not on our own strength, we would ever return all of our thoughts and our actions to you. We ask this through the same Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God.
forever and ever. Jesus Christ our Lord. You sent us Jesus Christ, who conceived by the Holy Spirit, was born of the Virgin Mother, Mary most holy. We have come to know and love you as our perfect Father through the revealed mystery of your incarnate Word. We praise you, Father, and through your Son now made visible, long to be with you, our unseen God. Therefore, the angels and archangels, with all the saints and the entire church, we lift our hymn of praise to your glory, repeating unceasingly. Holy, 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 God of power and grace, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. We therefore, most merciful Father, through Jesus Christ, your Son and our Lord, most humbly beseech you to accept and to bless these gifts, these presents, these holy, unspotted sacrifices, which your holy church receives from you, imploring you to defend and guide it throughout the world, together with her priests and all true believers of the holy faith. Remember, Lord, your servant. All present in this congregation, imbued with faith in your holy care, your rule, and fatherly love, wholeheartedly this day, we unite in spirit with all of those. We give the most blessed Mother Mary, Mother of Jesus Christ, likewise his apostles, and all the countless hosts of martyrs and confessors who lived, labored, and suffered for the same holy cause which Jesus Christ sacrificed his life and his most precious blood, just as they believed, professed, and united with you through prayer and this immaculate oblation, which you have instituted in the beginning of the world, and in time have fulfilled through Jesus Christ, and gave it to humanity as a pledge of eternal salvation. So we too this day profess and unite ourselves with you, most gracious Father, in humbleness of spirit, and accept from your hands this holy bread and this precious chalice as a longed-for gift bestowed on us by the Savior of the world as spiritual food and drink. He promised us this food and drink in that moment, when he revealed his divine power by the multiplication of bread and feeding with it a hungry multitude of people. Afterward, he foretold the giving of that food and drink to his disciples and friends as a more excellent nourishment when he said, "It is my Father who gives you the real heavenly bread. I myself am the living bread come down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he shall live forever. The bread I will give is my flesh for the life of the world." And afterwards, when the temporal and messianic life of the divine teacher and giver of the covenant was drawing to a close, he gathered into the upper room all of those who he loved in a singular way and had chosen to continue his work of salvation. He spoke to them words of deep love, longing, and resolve. "I will not leave you orphaned. I will come back to you. I am the way, the truth, and the life. You are my friends if you do what I command you. Do not be distressed or fearful. You will suffer in the world, but take courage. I have overcome the world. If you live in me, and my words stay a part of you, you may ask what you will, and it will be done for you. Anyone who loves me will be true to my word, and my Father will love him. We will come to him and make our dwelling place with him. I consecrate myself for their sakes now, that they may be consecrated in truth, that all may be one. As you, Father, are in me and I in you, I pray that they may be one in us, that the world may believe that you sent me. I have given them the glory you gave me, that they may be one as we are one. I living in them, you living in me, that their unity may be made complete. Father, all those you gave me, I would have with me in my company where I am to see this glory of mine, which is your gift to me, because of the love you bore me before the world began. I myself am the bread of life. No one who comes to me shall ever be hungry, No one who believes in me shall ever thirst. After these and other words of the archpriestly prayer and with holy fervor, our Savior took bread into his holy and venerable hands, and having lifted his eyes to heaven, to you, his almighty Father, giving thanks to you, he blessed it, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat it, for this is my body, which is given for you." In like manner, after supper, taking this excellent chalice into his holy and venerable hands, again he gave thanks to you, blessed it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the cup of my blood, the blood of the new and everlasting covenant, which shall be shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you do this, do it in remembrance of me." Wherefore, mindful Lord, we your servants and your faithful people, in remembrance of this Christ, your Son and our Lord, as well as his blessed passion, resurrection, and his glorious ascension, receive from your own gifts and presents a pure offering, a holy offering, an immaculate offering, the holy bread of eternal life, and the chalice of everlasting salvation. These gifts we receive with a joyful countenance, as from him who is the giver of all temporal and eternal good gifts, and with an unshakable faith that they will become for our souls a saving remedy. We humbly ask you, Almighty God, to command that our offering be brought by the hand of your holy angel to your highest altar, into the presence of your divine majesty. That we who receive the most sacred body and blood of your Son from this altar may be filled with every blessing and grace through Christ our Lord. Amen. Lord, remember your servants who have gone before us with the sign of faith, and who have passed on to eternity. To these souls, Lord, and to all who rest in Christ, grant everlasting life, and to those who during life stray from the path of righteousness, unmindful of your fatherly love, mercifully shorten their sufferings. We ask this in the name of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And grant us, your sinful servants, who hope in the greatness of your mercy, some part in fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs, and all your saints who shed their blood for your name. Their hearts were always open to justice and mercy, and with lives patterned after their divine master, merited eternal joy. Number us in their company, Lord, not weighing our merits, but pardoning our offenses, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. By whom you always create, sanctify, revive, bless, and freely give us all these good things. Through him, and with him, and in him, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit. Forever and ever. Instructed by our Savior's teaching and following divine example, we say with confidence,
"Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done. As it is in heaven,
Florence Molly, past, present, and future, and by the intercession of the blessed and glorious Mother of God, Mary, together your blessed apostles, Peter and Paul, as also Andrew and all the saints, grant us peace in our days, supported by the help of your mercy. May we always be free from sin and secure from all disturbance. Through the same, Jesus Christ, your Son and our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, forever and ever. May the peace of the Lord be with you always. May the union of divinity and humanity in Jesus Christ bring us sanctification and eternal life. Amen. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us peace. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, I leave you peace, my peace I give you. Do not look at our sins, but on the faith of your church, and grant us the peace and unity of your kingdom, for you live and reign forever and ever. Amen. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of the living God, by the will of the Father and the work of the Holy Spirit, your death brought life to the world. By your holy body and blood, free me from all my sins and from every evil. Keep me faithful to your teaching, and never let me be parted from you, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. May the partaking of your body and blood, Lord Jesus, not be cause of my judgment. Though I am unworthy to receive this great sacrament, through your loving kindness may become my safeguard and healing remedy. My saving Master, awaken in me a living faith, fervent love, worship, adoration, and a holy longing. Through this communion, make me your willing servant, zealous to fulfill your holy will. May it at last unite me entirely with you, my Lord and my God. Grant this who lives, reigns with God the Father, in unity with the Holy Spirit, forever and ever. Amen. I will take the bread of heaven, and I will call upon the name of the Lord. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. May the body of our Lord Jesus Christ bring me to everlasting life. Amen. What shall I return to the Lord for all the graces that he has given me? I will take the chalice of salvation, and I will call upon the name of the Lord. With high praise will I call upon the Lord, and I shall be saved from all my enemies. May the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ bring me to life everlasting. Amen. Behold the Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. Body. Body and the blood of Christ.
and the blood of Christ. The body 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 and the blood of Christ. And the body and the blood of Christ.
Myself and all of those for whom I have offered it, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
May the Almighty and merciful God bless you. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. John. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was in God's presence, and the Word was God. He was present to God in the beginning. Through him all things came into being, and apart from him nothing came to be. Whatever came to be in him found life, life of the light of men. The light shines out in darkness, the darkness that did not overcome it. There was a man named John sent by God, who came as a witness to testify to the light, so that through him all might believe, but only to testify to the light, for he himself was not the light. The real light which gives light to every man was coming into the world. He was in the world, and through him the world was made, yet the world did not know who he was. To his own he came, and his own did not accept him. And he who did accept him, he empowered to become children of God. These are they who believe in his name, who are begotten not by blood, nor by carnal desire, nor by man's willingness, but by God. And the Word became flesh, and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of an only Son coming from the Father, filled with enduring love.